into our Founder's Day program. Would you all please rise for posting of the poll? Thank you all so much. You may be seated. Let me just say good morning again. And may I get a good morning back? Again. Thank you. We've been in existence for 113 years. I think that warrants some enthusiasm this morning. I am Shanta Haywood, and I have the honor of serving as the Vice President for Institutional Advancement here at Albany State University. And I am honored again to be presiding this morning over our convocation as we celebrate 113 years. As we allow the rest of our guests to come on in, I would like for Reverend Lou Jean Bush to come forward. And bring us our invocation. And immediately after Reverend Bush, we will have a selection, and we would like for the audience to join us in singing, Lift Every Voice and Sing.
Let us pray. Our Father God, our Creator and our Maker, we thank you for this day. We thank you for 113 years. We ask if it be thy will to continue to bless this university, bless the president and his staff, continue to lead them and guide them to help to take this university to even greater height. We ask this prayer and these blessings in your son Jesus' name we pray, and all God people say it. Amen.
Thank you.
Let's give our students another round of applause. That was magnificent. And Dr. Hood, I have a small confession. I was supposed to stand on the side while this was being sung, but I always wanted to be in the chorus. But they wouldn't let me because I can't sing, which is why I put the microphone away from my mouth when they were singing. So I snuck up here just to make myself feel as if I were a part of the chorus. At this time, we will have our, we will bring up royalty. Albany State University's, Miss Albany State University, Miss E. Andrea Joseph, will bring the occasion and welcome. And following Miss Joseph would be Travis Clemens, who is the royal gentleman, and he will give a tribute to our founder.
Good morning. Good morning, President Art Dunning, distinguished speaker, Ms. McGee, faculty, staff, students, and alumni. The tremendous growth and evolution of our beloved university 113 years later, here we still stand, a forward-thinking institution with a vision to impact the world. Perhaps we shall not know in this present age, if the visionary founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, had this ASU in mind. Perhaps I would like to think and believe, however, that he did have some inkling. I would like to believe that he dreamed a dream as Dr. Martin Luther King Jr. did. I would like to believe that Dr. Holly envisioned an evolution of ASU and its impact on a global society. I would like to think that he saw Africa, Asia, North and South America all touched by faculty and staff and students at ASU. Students are participating in internships. There are new facilities. There is a new Albany State University impacting the world on a higher level. So, we have gathered here this morning to commemorate the dreamer, the visionary, as well as the fruition of Albany State University. So, those of us who love and support Albany State University, let us celebrate this grand old institution that is yesterday, today, and tomorrow, and be ever mindful that we have a past to cherish and a future to fulfill. Thank you.
Good morning. Perhaps this all began as a dull, muffled voice crying from deep within his soul as he went about his day-to-day business. Or maybe it was the resounding, reverberating, piercing cry that could not be drowned out by any effort as he lay slumbering upon his bed. Yes, perhaps it was just that crescendoing, echoing, vibrating sound that urged our founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, to leave what had become his home at such a tender age, not even 30 years old yet, and come to Southwest Georgia to begin a school for Negroes. Albany Bible Emmanuel Training Institute is what he would dub it. Dr. Holly set out to Albany, Georgia, the place where he would release the pent-up cry and watch his dream, his potential, in seed form take shape and begin to come to fruition. Good morning, administrators, faculty, staff, students, and the entire ASU community. I am absolutely delighted to pay homage to our founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, and to the university that I have grown to love as your Mr. Royal Gentleman. Each year we gather here to celebrate the legacy of Dr. Holly and pay tribute to him. That legacy is the ever-imminent, ever-expanding, and ever-unsinkable Albany State University. You see, Holly's desire to become a change agent in Albany was the impetus for all that we and tens of thousands of others are now privileged to be beneficiaries. Who would have imagined 113 years ago the potential that rested within the great mind of Dr. Holly would produce an HBCU so rich in tradition, family, and education? Who could have envisioned what could be done with only 50 acres of land along the Flint River and a hope that ran deeper than the depths thereof? There were some who said the cry would never be heard and picked up by others. There were some that said a risk this big should not be taken and would not succeed. Those naysayers didn't have the great sight that spreads out before us now that our beloved founder possessed. For that, I thank not only Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, but also his lovely family. I can only imagine how pleased Dr. Holly could be to know that the students who have and are currently attending this great institution are being flung into the winds of society and are scattering the seeds in which they received here in the uttermost parts of the earth. Now, we as students are tasked with making sure that his vision and his dream do not go in vain and that his legacy lives on forever. Remember, your destiny fulfilled is your tribute to Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Eandria and Travis. I think that you all will make Dr. Holly so proud. You all are so smart, so driven, and so ambitious, and you all represent the type of students that are here at Albany State University, and we're just so proud of you all, and we expect wonderful things from you all in the future. We have so many people in the community who think that this occasion is extremely special, and they take time out of their busy schedules to come out and bring greetings and to show their support for Albany State University. The Honorable Dorothy Hubbard, who is our mayor and also a graduate of Albany State University. Mr. Christopher Cojillas, he's not here, but he felt that it was so important that we know how much he appreciates Albany State, so he sent a greeting, and I will read that for him. We have Laurentis Gaines, who is the president of the student body. We have Ms. Josiah Ricks, who is the president of the National Alumni Association. And we have a very, very special treat today, Mrs. Josephine Holly Jefferson, Dr. Holly's daughter. And I would like to change the order just a little bit. Come on up, Mayor Hubbard, and ask that Mrs. Holly speak last. Thank you. After Mrs. Ricks.
Good morning. Five score, 1 decade, and 3 years ago, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly brought forth to the state of Georgia the idea of a new school, dedicated to the proposition of wiping out illiteracy in Albany and Daugherty County. Dr. Holly was a Methodist preacher, a Christian, and a believer. And I would venture to say that he talked with, honored, praised, glorified, and worshiped our God often, and that he believed that if he kept the faith, prayed to God daily, and kept on trying, his dream would come to pass. I am delighted to be here this morning to bring you greetings as mayor of the Good Life City, and to bring you greetings on behalf of the Board of Commissioners of the City of Albany, Georgia, and the city staff. We are happy to join the Albany State University family this morning to pay tribute to our beloved founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly. Our examination of yesterday, which symbolizes the past, helps us to understand the history and struggles that Dr. Holly must have endured. We can only imagine how hard it must have been, and so we pay tribute to him for his vision and dreams. An examination of today helps us to understand the present and our responsibility to continue to build on Dr. Holly's foundation and legacy. We must never forget our responsibility to give more than we get and to help educate future generations. So we pay tribute to him today for his dreams and his vision. An examination of tomorrow, which symbolizes the future, helps us to understand that we have the responsibility to make the future brighter for those following in our footsteps. Understanding yesterday, giving back today, help us to ensure a brighter tomorrow. So we pay tribute to Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly for his vision and his dreams. Albany State University, yesterday, today, and tomorrow. Thank you.
Good morning, family, friends, and alumni. Good morning, family, friends, and alumni. My name is Laurentius Gaines. I am a 21-year-old senior political science Spanish minor hailing from Augusta, Georgia, and I have the honor of serving as the 2015-2016 Student Government Association president. On behalf of our esteemed student body and student government, I would like to bring you greetings, and I leave you with this. If it's strong enough, we built it. If it's tough enough, we created it. If it's an institution of higher learning built on a legacy, legacy to succeed, then it is none other than the unsinkable Albany State University, home of the mighty Golden Rams. Enjoy your day.
I'm going to share with you the letter that Commissioner Cahia sent. On behalf of the Daugherty County Board of Commissioners, it is my pleasure to welcome you to this year's 113th Annual Founders Day Convocation. More than 100 years ago, Albany State University was founded by Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, a pastor, educator, philosopher, and a man of vision. His dedication to providing a quality education to students across Southwest Georgia is a guiding principle of the institution's rich history and further its very promising future. This is an important event where we as citizens, students, and alumni come together in collaboration to recognize and honor Albany State University's rich history and significance of our community, the education of our youth, and the future of our region. The collaboration that goes into bringing about this event should not be overlooked. It requires that students, old and new, faculty, staff, and citizens come together for purposes of honoring the history of ASU and taking steps to ensure its positive growth into the future. Collaboration and focus of purpose are qualities that one finds in any successful organization. Not surprisingly, These qualities are reflective of the guiding principles that Dr. Holly established for this institution of higher learning. Dr. Holly was truly a man of great vision and purpose. This is self-evident as we have all come here today more than 100 years later after he founded this institution to acknowledge and honor his work. Mr. Cohias welcomes you all to Founders Day and thanks you for your important and symbolic assembly here as we reflect on not only this institution's rich history, but further its very bright future.
Good morning. On behalf of the Albany State University National Alumni Association, let me express my gratitude for the opportunity to welcome and greet each of you. I stand grateful for my heritage, grateful for my education at this institution, yet hopeful and expectant of a brighter future for my alma mater. I believe that your presence signifies the same respect and understanding. The faith of our founder is living still. And looking back at the wonderful history of Albany State, I thought about the lyrics of a song written by Curtis Mayfield. I've got to keep on pushing. I can't stop now. Move up a little higher, some way or somehow. 'Cause I've got my strength, and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Now, maybe someday I will reach that higher goal. I know that I can with a little bit of soul. 'Cause I've got my strength and it don't make sense not to keep on pushing. Thank you.
Would you all join me in welcoming Mrs. Holly Jefferson to the stage?
Good morning, Albany State University, President Dunning, faculty, students, and friends and members of my family. I am pleased to be here to greet you this morning. I was sorry to have missed the last two Founders Day celebrations, but I'm very grateful to be here today. This is a time of change, changes in the world, in the nation, and here at Albany State. Change is sometimes challenging, but we must all change and accommodate to changes in our lives if we are to survive. The benefit of change is growth and wisdom. Embracing change requires a certain amount of risk-taking, but without that risk, without that embrace, nothing moves forward. Embracing change and moving forward to new horizons, accepting new challenges, was a hallmark of my father's life. It is his legacy to all of you. There have been many positive changes that I see all around me as I visit you this year. and that I have heard about as I have kept up to date with the life of the university. I have heard about the trip to the Rose Bowl. What an exciting and exhilarating adventure. I am pleased to hear about, and I look forward to the groundbreaking ceremonies of the Fine Arts Building. My father would be so proud of the many opportunities that are becoming available to students today and in the coming years. As each of you moves forward in your life, consider how you can respond positively to the changes that will come, some that you may not necessarily be able to control, but also, and perhaps more important, consider what changes you can make for the good, no matter how small, that will make a positive difference in your world. I have the good fortune to look back on the past, to see the university as it is today, and to hold on to the hope of a bright future for Albany State. So embrace the positive changes that your generation is fortunate to claim as your own, and be the catalyst for even greater achievement for those who will follow you. So my wish for you today is that you will honor the gifts of the past, that you will live fully and embrace each present moment, and that you will hold on to your brightest dreams for the future, a past to cherish, a present to embrace, a future to fulfill, one past, one present, one ASU. Thank you.
What an honor to have our founder's daughter here on our campus and talking about our future here at Albany State. We all know that Dr. Holly is resting here on our campus, and normally after our programs, we go and have a gravesite ceremony. Because of the weather and because we were uncertain as to how it would turn out, we've changed the order of that, and we will be having that ceremony here inside the auditorium immediately after the program. So please remain to enjoy just 5 minutes of honoring Dr. Holly as we symbolically place the wreath here on the stage, and we will take it later to the gravesite. Dr. Hood.
Thank you.
tell you, I know that we have some of the most talented students in the state university system. Come on up. We will now have the introduction of our speaker by one of our future dynamic leaders and future donors, our vice president for our Student Body Association.
Greetings, everyone. I am Amber Kennedy, Vice President of Student Government Association, and this morning I have the privilege of introducing our guest speaker. Carmen Camille McGee, MD, was born May 31st, 1972, in Columbus, Ohio. She was the only child of Edith and Edgar Bayon McGee. Life with her mom took her to Toledo, Ohio, where she was reared in St. Paul Baptist Church. With her large and lively family, her childhood was marked by academic excellence at St. Hyacinth Catholic Elementary School. And then, as a salutatorian of Robinson Junior High School, she eagerly moved to Albany, Georgia, with her mother and stepfather, Keith. Staying true to form, McGee found her place in academics at high school, Albany High School, where she was ranked top 5% of her class. Much to her delight, she was surprised by a visit one morning from none other than Dr. Billy C. Black himself. At her school, he offered her a full scholarship to attend Albany State College, as we know, university, as a presidential scholar. In 1990, McGee entered the freshman class to pursue her undergraduate degree in biology. She made the dean's list her first year and completed all her course requirements for her major by the end of her second. Her college career was highlighted by her induction into Alpha Kappa Mu Honor Society. She did manage, however, to have fun. As a member of Alpha Kappa Alpha Sorority Incorporated, the 1992nd and 93rd Miss Albany State Royal Court, and as the captain of Honda Campus All-Star Challenge Team. Through steady guidance from home and school, McGee was accepted into every medical school in which she applied. After graduating from Albany State with honors, she chose to attend Eastern Virginia Medical School in Norfolk, Virginia. In Norfolk, she served as the local chapter president for the Student National Medical Association. In 1998 to now, Miss McGee moved to Chicago to train in a rigorous obstetrician and gynecologist residency. She was the only African-American resident in her department and one of only two in the entire hospital. During her fourth year, she was named chief resident of the program and winning high praise for attending physicians for surgical skill and warm bedside manner. Upon completion of her doctoral degree and special training, she felt a strong pull of family ties and decided to move to her roots in Atlanta, where her family had migrated. She took her first job as an associate physician with a private practice and as an active member of the OBGYN residency teaching staff at Atlanta Medical Center. In only her second year of her practice, she completed her certification through the American Board of Obstetrician and Gynecology to become a fellow of the American College of Obstetrician and Gynecologists, CMAC, as she is affectionately called, was twice honored as the CREOG Teaching Attending of the Year at Atlanta Medical Center. She was the first African-American physician and female to gain this distinction. Dr. McGee's career path has given her the opportunity to care for those who are underserved and very ill along the way. Currently, she is also in solo practice in Atlanta suburb of Loganville. She has been nominated for the Gwinnett County Chamber of Commerce Excellence in Medicine Award. Additionally, she is department chairperson for the Eastside Medical Center and serves at the Medical Executive Committee. However, if you asked her what she is most proud of, she would reply, "Is it an honor to be the mother of Cameron, her son?" For 7 years, she has enjoyed serving as the chief launderer, cook, and boo-boo fixer. Dr. McGee would say that it has added joy to her life and grounded her in ways she did not know possible. Ladies and gentlemen, please join me in welcoming alum, fellow AKMUN, and none other than Dr. Carmen Camille McGee.
Wow. You made me sound better than I thought I could be. Thank you. Thank you, Father God, for bringing us together to celebrate the exemplary heritage of your servant and Albany State University's founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly. To President Dunning, the Founders Day Committee, government officials, and the Holly family. Thank you for allowing me the privilege of participating in the commemoration of our rich heritage. To the student body, past, present, and future, you've been in the forefront of my mind and the inspiration for my words. Last but not least, to my curb crew, that's what we call it when you're running road races, it's your cheerleading squad, my son and boss, Cameron, the glue that holds me together, my mom, Edith Jones, my paternal athletic trainer, Wilbur Jones, and my uncle and aunt, Maurice, and Darnese Calhoun, thank you all for making the trek down here to cheer me on. Now, you could have chosen any other student to return home to Albany, but I am so grateful that you invited me. The education and the degree that I received at Albany State College were and continue to be a great blessing to me. It was here that I was given the guidance, support, and academic foundation that helped me be accepted into every medical school with which I applied. Your unwavering belief in me instilled confidence that propelled me into the medical specialty of my choosing and my first choice of obstetrics and gynecology residency training programs. A great investment is made into every student, and I am thrilled to be an example of a return on that investment. One day, 27 years ago, I was a little late arriving to Albany High School, as sometimes I am. The principal's office called for me, and I just knew that I was going to be in big trouble. The secretary, in a very solemn voice, told me to go to the library. She said that the principal was waiting for me. I was certain that was the end of my academic career. There, sitting at a table, was an imposing looking group of people. I thought, oh no, it's going to be an inquisition. Then someone said, Carmen, Dr. Billy Black from Albany State College is here to present you with a presidential scholarship offer. What seemed like the end turned out to be the beginning. Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly was the son of sharecroppers from Winnsboro, South Carolina. He quickly learned the value of education while witnessing the industrial hierarchy of a plantation based on one's knowledge of a skilled trade. Of his siblings, he was deemed the brightest and thus afforded opportunities to study that the others didn't receive. This fostered belief in his own abilities and carried him to the Northeast, where he stood unintimidated and sought the ability to further his academic advancement into the seminary. Along the way, he formed an enduring relationship with a wealthy Massachusetts family, the Hazards, who became financial benefactors. But also, he made the acquaintance of two great men, Frederick Douglass and Booker T. Washington, who planted seeds of social awareness that motivated him to look beyond his present circumstance. However, it was when he read W.E.B. Du Bois, The Soul of Black Folks, that that two chapters in the book dedicated to the state of affairs for poor, uneducated blacks in Daugherty County, Georgia, that gave his life and career new meaning. While fulfilling his original plan of working in ministry in Macon, Georgia, he answered his higher calling in education. His body of work began in prayer and supplication, where on his knees he asked God to order his actions as he boldly left all that he knew to come to a potentially dangerous geographic area to improve the lives of people that he didn't even know. As a physician and surgeon, I routinely have to get to the core of a patient's problem to make a diagnosis and develop a treatment plan. As I began to explore the theme of this year's Founders Day celebration, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, I was compelled to understand what made Dr. Holly do what he did for this community. With research and reflection, the answer came in one word, and it was dignity. It is imperative that this word be used with a full understanding of its meaning and subsequently how it relates to his vision. We should know that dignity is different from respect in that it is the inherent self-worth one has simply because they exist, whereas respect is the self-worth that one has earned. It was crystal clear to Dr. Holly that as a child of God, poor, uneducated blacks in this rural area had to be reintroduced to the notion that no matter what they'd experienced, their lives had value. He realized that this population needed a means to tap into the dignity that was their birthright. What better way to do exactly that than to share the power of education and equip them with the skills needed to function at a higher capacity in their society, thus setting them up to earn the respect of others. Through a $2,600 gift, equivalent to $62,271 today, this gift from the Hazard family And with the logistical assistance of an all-white board of trustees, Dr. Holly secured land, which was prime real estate at that time, along the banks of the Flint River. And in 1903, launched the Albany Bible and Manual Training Institute. By 1917, through any number of challenges, Dr. Holly led this institution to financial success and recognition from the state of Georgia to become a state-supported two-year college, the Georgia Normal and Agricultural College, forging ahead through, I'm sure, artful negotiation and compromise. Dr. Holly's baby became a part of the university system of Georgia in 1932. Finally, under his watch, it evolved into a four-year teaching training institute called Albany State College. This coincided with his retirement in 1943. I would be remiss not to mention the progression to Albany State University in 1996 under the leadership of Dr. Billy C. Blatt. In medicine, we often say that a patient's history is the best predictor of what is to come. So as we look at where we've been and where we are today, it should come as no surprise that we're in a season of change. Let Dr. Holly's fearless desire to improve the lot of others with a keen understanding of negotiation be a guide as we engage in the latest version of this institution, whereby Albany State University unites with Darton College. For we know that change is inevitable, and as a result, require steadfast faith that what is to come will only result in the good of all involved. That being said, we're used to the growth and development that is being experienced now, and we will be just fine. To the Albany State University body, student body, that has championed its legacy as a historically black college and university, I say, kudos. Congratulations for adopting Dr. Holly's commitment and spirit by insisting that we pay homage to that which he started.
You are the future leaders of this institution. Because you're here now, you've proven to be guardians of the past and champions of tomorrow. Let me go on record as saying that I am very proud of my HBCU, which can also be called a historically beneficial college and university. To President Dunning, campus officials, and personnel, my hat's off to you. Undertakings of this magnitude require strong leadership, sensitivity, and diplomacy, which you've employed as you attend to the student body, alumni, and to each other. It is the vulnerability of transition that causes fear and anxiety. We all know that only a baby likes a change. For the record, nothing stays the same. This season of transition will come to an end. As you go through, periodically look back at our forefathers' example. Because who we are today is evidence enough that they had the right idea. For students, there's probably concern about preservation of Albany State and Darton College's identity. For those who make a living working at either of these institutions, I'm sure there are concerns about job security, career maintenance, and professional advancement. It is likely, though, that a spirit of genuine compromise will prevail. However, when deemed absolutely necessary, vigorous debate is sometimes required. But maintenance of the commitment to the greater good of all should be the driving force. As those of us who are battle-tested know, you must pick and choose your battles wisely. While this may be an uncomfortable time, it pales in comparison to the crisis that some of our sister HBCUs have faced recently. Historically, as a people, we've faced sweeping changes like abolishment of slavery, civil rights, and the election of the first African-American president of the United States of America, Barack Obama. As we courageously face the mystery of tomorrow, I encourage everyone to use our illustrious past as a directive for accomplishing great and lofty goals. As the dust settles from the changes taking place now, perhaps we can push the envelope further open in advancing from a state university status to a comprehensive university status where doctoral degrees are conferred, or perhaps even to the elite status of the research institution. To the student body again, you have an integral role in this school's future, in that your success breeds success. Perhaps a judicious use of your powers of persuasion can be used to improve the disparity between male and female students at both institutions, which right now, I think both schools are running 1/3 male and 2/3 female. Consider going back to high schools to recruit qualified students for Albany State University. What you have to say is what matters most, is what they're going to hear, more so than from someone like me. As you become alumni, wear your ASU, your Albany State University experience proudly, and let others see the best that Albany State University has to offer, which is you. So many seemingly lofty goals are out there. You have only to believe that we are worthy of all of them. Then go out and make them happen. My graduating class of 1994 far surpassed what I bet was Dr. Holly's original vision. We were leaders in medical school acceptance per capita across the board, meaning compared to all schools in the United States, we were in the top 10. Great students, like my friends, Dr. Marla Black Morgan, who's an acclaimed neurologist, came out of that class. Dr. Jermaine Cummings, who's a business savvy solo practitioner of internal medicine, and Dr. Carlos Williams, who's explored the world in international service of medicine, came from that group. Dr. Holly's memoir, You Can't Build a Chimney from the Top, brings to mind the old hymn saying, on the solid rock I stand, all other ground is sinking sand. According to his writings, what is now Albany State University has a foundation strong enough to withstand the challenges of today's transition. Let me be clear, we will continue to be an environment that thrives tomorrow. I encourage all of us to stand on the shoulders of our phenomenal leaders, past and present. For me, as a graduate of the science department, I think of Dr. Ora Lockley, who insisted on academic excellence. Dr. Edwin Green, who created the roadmap for acceptance into medical school. Coach Oliver Jones, who would teach you how to swim all the while taking our basketball teams to championships. Dr. C.W. Grant, who allowed me to vent about dormitory life, and to his wife, the late Dr. Velma Grant, whose command of the King's English continues. It never fades from my memory. Finally, stand on the shoulders of Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, a most dignified intellectual whose deep relationship with God and belief that through him all things are possible. Let the words of our alma mater echo in your thoughts. I'm not going to say the whole alma mater, but the portion that matters most is here for me. Albany State, we dearly love you, whose walls are inscribed with knowledge so true, so solidly built on this foundation, a union of work and inspiration. Once again, I thank you.
Dr. McGee, we have a token here for you, but I want to say something first. One of my favorite philosophers is Frantz Fanon, and he says that each generation must, out of relative obscurity, define its mission and either fulfill it or betray it. So while we like to give these as tokens and as a part of tradition, I'd like to give you this as a thank you for fulfilling your personal mission. Thank you. Let's give her another vivacious round of applause. How many students are here? Could you raise your hand? I want you all to look at Dr. McGee. This is who you are going to be, even though she's just 30 years old. See how much you got to pack, Laurentis? You say you're a 21-year-old hailing from your city. In 9 years, you got to do all of that. But you all have a tremendous future ahead of you because of the foundation that's been laid here by Albany State and because of Dr. Holly's vision, and we're expecting great things from you. Dr. Dunning will now come up and give acknowledgments and recognition for our 25-year employees. Dr. Dunning has proven to be an exemplary leader here at the university, so the only introduction he needs right now is welcome the president of Albany State University.
Dr. McGee, I have heard many speeches, and yours is one of the best. This is a very you in many ways capture the future, but you also capture the angst that a lot of people may feel. But one of the things that's so permanent about this country and about this world is change. And I don't know of any place where that has ever been easy for a lot of people. But you were able to celebrate this sort of view of the future that's valuable for all of us. And I think about Dr. Holly, what it must have been like 113 years ago, coming here in Albany, Georgia, in a place that in many ways was a difficult place, not just in Albany, but throughout the southern part of the United States of America. And he chose to kind of put a stake in the ground to educate people who, for many people in this country, said could not be educated. And for a man to have that sort of vision, for us to sit here in 2016, that's extraordinary. And I'm happy to have his daughter here. All of us should be so blessed to hear our father or mother talked about the way she was able to hear this morning. So thank you for what you've done, and thank you for what you've said. We have a number of people here I want to acknowledge, and I think I saw some of them earlier, but city and county officials, you had a chance to hear from our mayor, who does an extraordinary job in Albany, Georgia. She's a person of this community, went to school here. I met her when she was President Black's chief of staff. I'm not sure what she was called, but that's what she did. So, Mayor, we thank you for your leadership in this community. The Holly family, you have no idea how much we treasure and how much we love for what you do year in and year out. It is an extraordinary thing to have a family who started something that lives and will live beyond all of us in this room. All of us in this room will experience Albany State, but this will live beyond us, and we thank you for that. Alumni, we have some very passionate and strong alums at Albany State University. I'm always interested in, when I have conversations with our alums, how much they love this place, how much they have been shaped by Albany State University. I often wonder what it is that we can do for this present generation of students who, in many ways, the attachment for things other than passion and tradition, because they've been exposed to so much technology, so much change, and so many things that many of us never knew, because they instantly can connect to anything that they wish to know. And then at times that gets in the way of tradition, because tradition is passed by very intimate ways from one human being to another. And so I wonder what we can do to make them feel as deeply attached to this place as some of the alums that I see day in and day out. That's an important thing. The other thing that I want to mention, Albany State is an extraordinary place. There's some things I've learned through this consolidation process. Some facts and some reality. Sometimes the gap between what people think about a place versus what the place is actually doing can be too wide. But we have some people who've achieved at the highest level, not for Albany State, but any place in this country. We have a chemistry program that's been ranked among America's best. We had people who come from the outside to do peer review of who we are and what we've done. And so that's extraordinary. The nursing programs by nursing.org. I want you to know that as this country ages, and the group between 1947 and 1965 moves through the process, we'll need health care like you wouldn't believe. And so, Dr. McGee, while you're bringing people into the world, there will be others who will help people as they age and move through this process. So nursing at Albany State is alive and well and being done extremely well, and we are delighted with that. The marching band, one of the things that I knew would happen, and a lot of us invested in that. If I knew we would see them on New Year's Day in Pasadena, California, they would look sharp and they would play well. And there would be people around this country talking about them. I went to a system office meeting in Atlanta. Almost every president that I had a chance to chat with talked about seeing Albany State. It didn't just make Albany State proud. It made the system proud. It made the state of Georgia proud. That was Albany State's legacy to this state. The U.S. Department of Agriculture gave us a $1.1 million grant to look at environmental programs. One of the things that we are challenged with in this country now is keeping our environment clean and pristine and as best we know how. We have scholars who think about that, who research and write about that. We got a $1.1 million at Albany State to do that. A $450,000 a National Science Foundation HBCU grant to help undergraduates in STEM education, science, technology, engineering, and mathematics. These are some of the jobs that will be growing extraordinarily strong in this nation. We have a grant to help our students in that area. And lastly, a Defense Department grant of $1.1 million. As we look at the challenges around the world of keeping communities safe, but we're looking at how we keep public health through bioterrorist attack. What that means are scholars and practitioners at Albany State who are digging deeply into the nature of things as they try to understand some of these processes. Dr. Holley provided this platform for us. He provided sort of the bricks and mortar under the ground that you can't see that we sit on right now. So what I've given to you is sort of the offshoots of what, when you have a strong foundation and how that works to the betterment of all. One of the things that Dr. McGee mentioned, we're in the midst of profound change, and you captured in the most extraordinary way some of the things that I think I feel and people are feeling as we go through this change. First of all, change is normal. And second, if we handle change well, there are benefits for everybody. There can be a process where 2 + 2 won't equal 4, but it'll equal 9. If we do that well and make sure there are no winners and losers in this process. The thing I'm most excited about is Albany State has the ability now to begin to think about a broader curriculum. We can add things to this campus like you would not believe. That requires us to be proactive and to think about that and to speak to the governing body about what those things are programmatically that we can do for Southwest Georgia. The other thing I'd like for you to think about is the impact on our region. We are a region that's challenged. It was challenged when Dr. Holley came here. But Dr. McGee, I think about what happens to young children from conception to birth. That's probably one of the things I'm most passionate about, is the health of the mother, the nutrition for a mother, and how many words are spoken before they get to the first grade at age 6. That's an issue for us in our region of the country. And one of the things I want us to begin to think about as we look at academic programs, not just what happens on the higher education end of it, but what happens with young kids that you see walking down the streets now, how do we do what we do to get them ready for higher education? That's a critical piece for Southwest Georgia. And you're a person who deals with this day in and day out. So I'd encourage you, all of us, and I spend my days thinking about the intensity of all of this, because believe it or not, everybody shares their opinion with me. There's no one who's held back in telling me what they think about this change. But what I want people in this room to know, as I move to the next phase of talking about people who help us and undergird us, we have some 25-year employees. And when I see these employees, these are people who've given a career to Albany State. They came here and they chose to stay here. They found a home. And one of the few people that I'd like to mention is Miss Helen Florence in military science. And if you're here, I hope you'll stand so we can be recognized. Miss Helen Florence, are you there? Second person, Mr. James Pullum in learning support. And Mr. Pullum, in here, are you here? Ms. Mary Ellison, custodial service. I'm very fond of Ms. Ellison. She works in this building, so when I come in the morning preoccupied with the things that are nagging me, she always has a fresh smile and kindness, and I appreciate that, Ms. Ellison. Ms. Andrea Felton, Academic Affairs. Is she here? And Mr. Robert Skinner, Academic Advisement and Athletics. The reason we want to recognize these employees, Albany State is not about bricks and mortar, it's about people. It's about what you heard Dr. McGee, she talked about people who shaped her, people who gave her a view of the future, and held her to a higher standard. And they were non-negotiable about that, about the language, about the skills, about the science, about mathematics. We need people to do that for us and be intense and demanding. So we have people who've given a career to Albany State, and we thank them for that. Albany State continues to be a place of foundation for students. what makes this an interesting and a fun job for me is looking at the next generation, because you can see what you can become. I can't think of anything more in this nation that you can offer young people as a platform to move to the mainstream, and not just on the fringes, but to shape policy. You heard something about Dr. McGee's medical skills, but she's on the policy side as well. She's not just doing the physician piece. She's helping shape directions and policies as well. And so we thank her for that, not just sticking to her knitting, but saying what happens, what should be done. That's where I want our students to begin to see themselves. And all of us who work at Albany State should be thinking about that. And we're not, we need to examine ourselves deeply, because the view of the future for this country and this region really resides in these young people. And our job is to help them be successful. Thank you so much for being here. I'm delighted with what we've had to celebrate today. And Dr. McGee, thank you and your family deeply. Thank you very much.
At this time, we would like to acknowledge our 25 years of service recipients with a plaque. Ms. Mary Ellison. Ms. Helen Florence. Years, just 1 year more than I'm old. That's amazing. I really am still amazed by that. And if you all have seen Miss Mary, she has more energy. I tell you. Let me make a few remarks. I've been getting these post-it notes like they pass them to you at church. The first one says that the missionary board will be meeting. It's a joke. And the ushers will meet afterwards. The first announcement is to remind you all that the National Alumni Association is having a luncheon here on campus in the student ballroom. Tickets are still available for $45. There is shuttle service available right outside of the atrium to the left to drive you there to the student union. And just so that you can know, most of the proceeds, a large number of the proceeds from that dinner, comes back to the university in the forms of scholarships for our students. There's also a business meeting with the National Alumni Association in 127 Peace Hall this evening, immediately following the luncheon. We will also be just celebrating, because every time we get together as a family, we have to eat. And there's nothing like a good fish fry. So we will be having our fish fry. If the weather doesn't hold up, we will be having it in Sanford. Is that right, Sue Polite Solomon? She's the real boss of me. Is that correct, Sue? Okay, in Sanford, we will be having the fish fry later on this evening. I also want to remind everyone that this week has been called a week of giving here at Albany State. And we began the week of giving with a party with a purpose in Atlanta. And we raised over $30,000 at that event. And while I hate to do this, to put him on the spot, I really don't, Gregory Heilick, Would you raise your hand, Mr. Heilig? I'm gonna put you on the spot. Mr. Heilig, at that event, we had a live auction. Mr. Leroy Campbell, who is an internationally renowned artist, did a special painting just for Albany State University in collaboration with the Tom Joyner Foundation. And the original piece was up for auction. $4,000, Mr. Heilig bought it. And because they were so inspired by his enthusiasm, knowing that it was going to be going to support a student, Dr. and Mrs. Dunning matched his $4,000 with another $4,000. We continued the week of giving by each day this week allocating a day for students, faculty, staff, and others to give, and alumni to give. And I just want to say this before we end. I'm a preacher's daughter, so you know it takes us five rounds before we conclude. I want to say that one of the most amazing days of giving that we had, it made the local news, was the student day of giving. ASU students came and they gave toward helping themselves. Let's give them a round of applause. That was just amazing to me. We are developing future donors. There's a method to our madness. But they gave, and I really appreciate that. So this week, with the students given, faculty and staff, we, in addition to what we raised in Atlanta, we've added an additional nearly $3,000. We have a goal of 50, and we have our staff out in the atrium if you want to continue to donate. I had to put that out there because that's my job. So with that, we would like to now retire the colors. Please stand. And afterwards, we will sing the alma mater. Thank you, and could you please remain seated for our placing of the wreath ceremony?
Good morning. We usually sing at the gravesite, but we're going to do it right here on stage this morning. The first song is Kyrie Eleison from the 16th century by Hans Leo Hassler, and the translation is Kyrie Eleison, Lord have mercy, Christe Eleison, Christ have mercy, Kyrie Eleison, Lord have mercy. And it will be followed by Done Made My Vow to the Lord, arranged by Moses Hogan.
Thank you.
Is Mr. Vincent Davis, there he is. Mr. Vincent Davis is the principal of Monroe Comprehensive High School, and he will bring the prayer and memorial statement. And the students who retired and brought the colors are also students at Monroe. So thank you for allowing them. Give them extra credit.
Thank you. Good morning. Let me say what an honor it is for me to have this opportunity to, first of all, this family, Dr. Hollis' family, thank you all for what you all continue to do for this great institution. And to Dr. Dunning and to the entire committee, thank you for this opportunity. I would like for the students to please come forward just very quickly, very, very quickly. I have to deal with you all for one more month, so I think I need to acknowledge you all very, very quickly. They don't know it yet, but these are future Golden Rams. So let me thank. That's good. That's good. Y'all can face the audience. Let me thank them for their service here today. We are on spring break, but these are 9th and 10th graders. The students who could perhaps be some other place, but they are here this morning. So let me thank you all for your service. You may go back to the beach or video games or the couch or whatever now. See you all Monday. You all pause for just one moment right there. Let us pray. You all pause for one moment. Let us pray, you all. Dear Heavenly Father, creator, sustainer of life, we thank you for this day and for this opportunity. We thank you for 113 years of such a prestigious, such a beneficial institution known as Albany State University. We thank you for the founder, Dr. Joseph Winthrop Holly, for having the insight and the vision to cast a stone out on the fields of nowhere and uproot from there seeds of greatness all over this great world. We praise you, we honor you, and we glorify you. We pray for the student body, the faculty, staff, and the leadership here at Albany State that they continue to be led and guided by you. We ask these blessings in your Son, Jesus' name, amen. Thank you all very much. I didn't know I had to do a prayer this morning, but if you are a high school principal, if you don't know how to do anything else, you know how to pray. So let me again thank this opportunity. I was reflecting, and they did ask for a memorial statement, and that it will be very, very brief. I remember the five B's. Dr. Colbert, who was one of my leadership professors here at Albany State, talks about, and asks, be brief, brother, be brief. So I'm going to keep those five B's. But as I thought about the theme here, yesterday, today, and tomorrow, my yesterday can be traced back 24 years ago when I signed an athletic scholarship to play for the Running Gun and Rams and the legendary coach Oliver Jones. It was an enormous opportunity for me coming from Albany, Georgia, to remain right here in Albany and play college basketball here at this great institution. And I have since received 3 degrees from this institution, all of which I'm still harvesting the benefits from the intellectual seeds that were planted right here on this campus. My yesterday also can go back further than that. My father, who in the 1950s would roam this campus with his uncle and help clean what was then Hazard Education Center, he eventually came to school here, as did his older sister, and his other sisters and brothers. So my aunts and uncles are all graduates of Albany State University. It didn't stop there. My youngest brother is also a graduate of Albany State University. And with that much blue and gold in your bloodline, I couldn't not marry a university a Golden Ram. So my wife is here. She's also, stand up, babe. My wife is here. She's also a graduate of Albany State University. But I think about yesterday. I think about yesterday and what yesterday, that yesterday means for all of us in this institution has just not been good for my family, but it has been good to all of us. And it continues to be so. It had to be such an enormous visionary to look out on a field and imagine this where we are now, this facility, the programs, the course offerings, the curriculum, the instructors, and all that exists now was such an amazing vision by Dr. Holly. I've learned so much on this campus, so many lessons that I can take from my yesterday, as I'm sure many of us can as well. Things that I learned in Sanford Hall. You see, I attended Albany State during the flood of 1994. I attended when we had classes in trailers, and although we were in mobile units, our brains were free to roam. Our brains were free to grow and develop. The intellectual capacity that we had on this campus never diminished. I was at Albany State when we had to have basketball games at a local high school. But that did not diminish the education that I received from this great institution. You see, Albany State remains unsinkable still today. And as we look at today, where we are today, we find ourselves in unique situations today, circumstances. And I heard Dr. McGee talk about the change. We see that there are opportunities all around us. Dr. Joseph Holly founded this institution on that very thing. Sometimes opportunities are difficult to see when we're so blinded by debate and controversy and challenge and change. But opportunities are plenty for us. And Dr. Holly realized that 113 years ago, was truly a visionary. As a local principal, my today involves interacting with alumni, interacting with potential graduates, interacting with individuals who are coming into the field of education to teach and yet make a difference in our community. Now, we must continue as alumni, we must continue as members of Albany State University to continue to carry that vision that Dr. Joseph Holly had years ago. And we end with tomorrow. What a tomorrow our university has ahead of us. You cannot build a chimney from the top. The foundation must be solid. I can only imagine the conditions of our city some 113 years ago when there was not so many issues that are prevalent as is today. I can only think of what our world looked like 113 years ago, where we were not afraid to ride a train or go to a ball game or attend church. There are so many things that are different now, but Dr. Joseph Holly knew the importance of establishing this great institution on a solid foundation. That foundation remains strong today. The strength of this foundation has been tested many times. The history of our university knew, Dr. Winthrop Holly knew, that the winds would blow and that the storms would come, but that our university would remain strong. He knew that we would be tested. He knew that our foundation had to be strong. He knew that, that adversity would be a critical and vital part to our university's success. Our university's foundation had to remain strong. You see, it was his foresight into the challenges and trials that Albany State would face that made him such a powerful visionary. World wars came, and yet our foundation remained strong. The Great Depression came, and yet our foundation remained strong. The denial of our rights as African Americans did not shake our foundation. And yes, even a natural disaster could not shake our foundation. As we look to tomorrow, there will be many circumstances and challenges that will challenge our resolve to keep our university's foundation strong. We must continue to be that institution that our community needs, our state needs, and that our world needs. We must continue to grow stronger. We must continue to build on the foundation. We must continue to move forward. We must continue to remain Albany State University. Thank you.
Thank you so much, Mr. Davis. And you know, you're truly family when you're on the program and didn't know what you're supposed to do. That's what we do. And you handled that prayer wonderfully. Thank you so much for that. At this time, we will move into the ceremony. I would like for the Holly family, all of you, to come up, please, to accompany Mrs. Josephine Holly Jefferson. You can leave your items there and come to the middle of the stage. Andrea, would you please come up as well? To the middle. Over here. And I will ask for Travis Clemens and Laurentis Gaines to bring the wreaths out. Later on today, we will take these wreaths and we will place them on Dr. Holly's grave. At this time, we will ask you to give a moment of silence. Thank you and amen. Reverend Bush, would you please come forward? Reverend Bush will give the benediction, and after that, our program will be concluded.
Our Father, we thank you for Dr. Holly, his vision, his legacy, of helping so many to realize their potential. We thank you for 113 years. We ask thy for strength to our president and his leadership that they may continue to lead and guide us to even greater height. We ask this in your name, Jesus, we do pray. And all God people said, amen. Amen.